big thing, other thing that I love to do is speak and facilitate. Like, I'm probably the most comfortable when I have a mic in my hand and or I have an opportunity to have an audience. I've done stand up and acting, but I now prefer to do it in an inspirational capacity with coaching my clients, as well as, you know, reaching audiences and helping them recognize that everything they ever need is inside of them.
Wow. You've done stand up? I did not know that.
I have. There's a video on the internet, actually, of me doing stand up. So.
Okay. Yeah, we're gonna have to Google that a little bit later. So wait, okay. I want to start there.
Okay.
Because I've seen people speak, I've seen people facilitate conversations, but what type of mental tenacity, like what do you have to tell yourself as you're preparing to go up in front of an audience and you know if a joke hits or if a joke fails, it's on you? Like, talk to me, Bryn. Talk to me.
Well, I think I love humor because I feel like it's a universal language. I heard someone say this. I don't remember the name of the individual, but basically said you laugh because it's true. And so when you have resonance with something that someone says, because you can see yourself in it, that's what causes the laugh. Because you're like, oh my God, my mom does talk like that. Or that happened to me last week, right? Now, the funny thing is every audience usually is seeing you for the first time. So now you can use that joke on repeat and you know when the laugh is going to happen. And that's the beautiful thing about stand up. And, you know, we see the very polished act. We don't see the fact that they did 20 clubs across the country working on that material, you know, improving that joke over and over and over again. So when you talk about mental tenacity, I think the key is to not be too attached to the idea that you have to kill, but that you have value. So when you go out, I think it's really important to know that I'm bringing value to this audience and they don't know me and I don't know them. I may know the subject, why they're here or any of that, but what I do know is humans. And as long as I know that I'm a human relating to other humans, there's usually going to be some resonance. As long as I don't feel like I have to be a certain type of person for them to listen to, and they don't feel like they have to be a certain type of person to relate to me.
Wow, I like that. Yeah, that's really good. And I like how you really separated the comedy from the comedian, or the comedy from the individual. Just going back to that human aspect. I really like that. That's good, Bryn. That's good.
Thank you.
Yeah,
thank
you. That's really good. That's really
good. I do want to add one additional thing on the comedy realm, and then we can get off of it. Mm-hmm. I heard this thing once, and I don't know if it was Adam Sandler or who told this story, but it was basically one of my favorite stories about speakers and audiences. And it was, you know, it was in the vein of comedy, a comedian telling the story, but it was essentially they used to work a club, and every time they were a new comedian, the owner of the club would come to that comedian and say, "How was the audience tonight?" And if the comedian said, they were not the best audience, they usually didn't get another time up because there are no bad comedians. I mean, no bad audiences, only bad comedians. Mm. And so as a speaker, as a coach, as anyone, when you're talking about the mental game, how can you take more ownership of the time at bat, if you want to use a sports analogy, and just know that, you know, it's not the pitcher, it's not the catcher, it's me. What happened at that at bat? How can I take ownership of what happened? Not in a fault way, but in a, hey, next time I'm at bat, here's what I would do differently.